Oh, I can hear this rice. Okay,
Should we
thank you
start with
everyone
oh.
for coming. Sorry. Okay.
No, it's okay. Cool, sorry.
So I've collected questions from, I've gotten some questions back from the judges who were judging the festival. I've gotten questions back from viewers who saw your films and then DM'd me questions. And then if that doesn't take up our time, I have personal questions, like questions for you guys that I have. But first, can we just, I'm pretty sure you all know each other, but in case you don't, go around, tell us who you are and which was your film that got nominated.
Hello, my name is Ryan. I directed Salt and Pepper.
Mm.
Hi, Jess.
Hello. My name is Christian. I directed Sounds of Science and Fistful of Paper. That's the title. So.
Brian, can we go to you? I don't know how you see this list.
Yeah, so my name is Brian Hamilton. I directed Calling Card, which is the one that was nominated, but I also worked on Goldfish as well.
Mo, Jess, can you hear us?
Oh, yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. Hey, guys, it's Mo Loggy here, and I directed The Perfect Pancake and Ski Mask the Slum God's music video, Billy and Mandy.
Hey.
Someone, finally!
Jessica, you're our last one.
I'm Jessica, and I wrote and directed Distractions.
Oh. Wow. Yes.
So first, I'm Juliet. I hosted the festival. I had a lot of fun watching all of your films, actually. I got to watch them as I was uploading them to YouTube, and I thought they were all really great. And I was surprised with the quality of films we had, considering that we only had 2 months before everything closed down. The fact that you guys were able to make films that were this good in that short amount of time, that was impressive. So the first film that came, the first question that came from a judge was, what was the most challenging part of actually creating your film, taking it from the script and putting it into a full-fledged concept on screen? And do you guys see a participant's order?
No, I do not.
I can see one.
Where is it?
On the bottom.
7?
Oh, I see. Yeah.
We just click that now. And then is it the same word for everybody or?
That's a really good question. Okay, let's just start with Jessica. How about you start us?
So you said challenge, right? Biggest mm-hmm. challenge. It would have to be location. Trying to find a place to film. I wanted like specific type of look, like a library setting, but we weren't able to film in a library, unfortunately. So we filmed on the bottom area at DVC. I don't know if that's considered the library, is it? Well, it was very difficult to figure out location, and because I really had a vision in mind of how I wanted this film to go. So that was my biggest challenge.
What I really liked about Jess's film was the sound design. Have you guys seen this Distractions? I really loved like when the photo comes up, you hit the sound and there's like no dialogue in it, but I still think you did a really good job on like telling the story.
I've seen it, and my hat's off to you as well for that film, because I like the way you did that editing. It's like how the show, the emotion first mm-hmm. and the feeling of it.
Thank you.
Yeah, do you mind, what camera did you guys shoot that on? Because it looked like really, really great.
Thank you. It was a Sony A7R3.
Okay, cool.
Yeah,
that looked really good.
I recently upgraded, so I definitely wanted to make it look good.
Awesome.
Okay, can we move? Does anyone else want to go next?
I can go next.
Okay, excellent.
In terms of like challenges, location had an idea. Concept had an idea. Location was not much of a problem because I did that on my dinner table, actually. In terms of challenges, more the comedic moments and the beats, I would say more the most challenge. On top of that, playing the marionette with the salt and pepper shakers was I was trying to get the right beat and the timing with my dialogue with the characters in it. I would say that would be the most challenge aspect of it, and making sure the timing was right when I was like playing with it.
For your film, did you shoot the dialogue as you were acting it out with the salt and pepper shakers, or did you record that separately?
I did that all together and had all the sound like put together already. Did I do it separately? No, I did not. I thought about doing that like most filmmakers, like I do off and on as well as a normal basis, but I just went with my gut on this. Pure instinct.
Feels more organic that way, I believe. It feels more like you're in the moment anyway.
Yeah, that's why I did it that method. I can't respond to that response because that's what I was going to say next.
Hi, Borna. Do you want to just tell us who you are and which film that you created that was in the festival?
Hi, how's it going? First of all, thank you so much, Julia, for getting us all around and doing all this festival. Thank you. So I'm Borna. My work was my persona's self-portrait, the black and white one. So that was, it took me only one day. It was just one day shooting and one day editing. It was all in Chicago with my friend. And yeah, that's basically it. It's about a time that I was just struggling with, like, who am I, or, you know, all this, the philosophy of the existing of self. So what does it mean that I exist, or what defines me? And all this kind of stuff with a lot of inspiration from Bergman's Persona. I created that, the short movie.
Okay, so for the first question, it was what was the most challenging part of making your film? And let's go to Christian now.
Okay. Wait, Juliet, should which one should I talk about? Fistful of Paper or Sounds of Science?
Well, they were both nominated, so I guess.
Oh, okay. So, okay. okay. Well, okay. I mean, I guess Fistful of Paper was pretty straightforward because we did that during the quarantine. And so. Really, I think the most challenging part of that was the fact that it was shot during quarantine. I don't really think there is anything really special with that. I mean, it was just kind of something I real quick and just wanted to shoot because I was kind of going crazy not shooting something. And so that's kind of what I did. For Sounds of Science, I guess that was kind of like a bigger production. And we had like a fog machine that we bought. And I think the biggest challenge with the entire like filmmaking process was definitely managing the fog machine. Cause if you guys couldn't tell, I shot that in my garage and we had lights and stuff. We shot like, we would go till like 1 a.m. A lot of times we would start like right when it got dark. And a big challenge with that was like not getting the cops called on us. Cause I thought like it would basically look like we were like a bunch of hippies in the garage from like the outside. Cause there was just a bunch of fog everywhere and it looked like we were just completely hotboxing it. And so we were very scared that like someone would just look at the window of the garage and just like be like, okay, they're doing something there. Like either the house is on fire or there's like Woodstock or something's happening there. So it was really challenging trying to manage that. And especially because I have very snoopy neighbors. And so we managed to get through it. And we would occasionally every like 10 to 15 minutes open the back door and just let all this fog out. It did look even worse because it looked like it was literally on fire with like fog just going up into the sky and everything. But it ended up working out and we got through it. So I guess that's my little spiel on it.
I didn't know that was shot in a garage. It looked like you'd gone into a lab at DVC and just, oh, really? I honestly thought you just knew someone who worked at DVC and they let you into one of the labs or something.
Oh, great. Awesome.
Okay, Brian, let's hear from you. Calling card.
Biggest challenge was time constraints. We had to shoot it within an hour. That's when we were allowed to have a lot of the equipment that we rented from DVC. So that's actually where a lot of problems with the sound came into play because we had an actual boom mic for basically half the movie and the other half, which is all like the movement shots that I got with my camera, didn't have really good audio. So I just kind of went with the camera audio, but really it was just time constraints. Other than that, everything was pretty much just flying by the seat of our pants, but it was fun.
If I didn't know that you shot that film in almost an hour, I wouldn't have known it from just seeing the film. I watched it. I was like, oh, that turned out really well. Okay. Okay, Mom.
All right, guys. First off, I want to say thank you, everybody, for being here, and you, Julia, for actually picking me. Like, I know I'm not part of this DVC thing.
I didn't pick you. The judges picked you. I didn't pick you. The judges have chosen.
Oh, judges, right. I'm from Sacramento, but, you know, I wanted to show my part in everything and help you guys out. So anyway, about the challenges. Well, focusing, first of all, since, believe it or not, I made this film completely by myself, The Perfect Pancake, all by myself. And actually, that wasn't really a challenge for me since I've made many films by myself, like secluded one person. But since this was a quarantine film, the focusing, I had to get a tripod and put like a bucket over it and just to get the focusing right. So as a stand-in. And well, that's that. Another challenge would be how I can make a compelling story with just like one person and an infinite object, and how that object can have personality, and which is the audio cassette recorder, and how I can mix up the comedy and the drama a bit. So like overall, I'm very proud of what I did. And I was even more surprised I was nominated for my performance, since I don't even consider myself an actor. But okay.
Okay, now I have some more specific questions. This question is for Orna and Brian. I got asked, why did you choose to do your films in black and white? Was there some significance? Was that a decision you made on production? And whoever wants to go first on that. Okay, Orna, you want to go first on that?
Okay. So my opinion, black and white is, first of all, it's easier to incept your idea because you don't have to deal with different colors and like transitions into different sequences. And secondly, as I think it's like it's easier to get the idea. Like it's simpler. You play with the contrast and you give a lot of like information and just idea, just pure ideas.
Okay, for my film, Calling Card, obviously it's noir spoof, so we had to film in a black and white. But it's cool, because it kind of made it all like monotone, and it fits the style, right? So this would be a noir parody, so that's why we shot in black and white.
Came out well. Okay, my next question came specifically for Jessica. We got asked if you could clarify for us the ending of it, and the figure, there's the figure, and he hands her the paper that says organic chemistry on it, and then he kind of disappears. And the judges were curious about like who that was supposed to represent. Did it represent something bigger, or was it just someone selling test answers?
So the ending is actually not the, well, it is the ending that I wanted, but I had a different plan that came right before the ending. He still disappears, but honestly, this film was kind of rushed because I filmed and edited for application, and it was due like in a week and a half, and so I was like, okay, I had to rush filming this. And honestly, the ending is kind of straightforward. Like she's just you know, distracted by all these things, and she, you know, comes up to this moral dilemma of whether to take the answers and you know, not study so that she can actually pass the right way, and so she shortcuts her way, and I just wanted to create a suspense off of that dilemma. I don't know if that answered.
I think so. Oh, sounds answered to me. But I liked that concept of the film, like seeing it in production and then seeing it in post-production. It sometimes tells two different stories, a lot of movies. Mm-hmm. Okay, next, I had a question for Christian. In Fistful of Paper, when you are playing both characters, right? So yes. We just wanted you to elaborate on that. Like, what was that like trying to... Basically, you're the star of the show, but you're two different people. And in particular, the final shot where like you're walking away and then it's a whip pan and it's back to you, that looked highly impressive. So what was it like playing two different characters in the same film?
Thanks. Yeah, it was really fun. I can't preface this enough. I'm not an actor, and I do not like acting at all, but like obviously I'll do it like if I need to. And so with this, like I kind of took like I honestly tried to pull off sort of like the deadpan comedy, sort of like Flight of the Conchords-esque comedy that is in that show. And I tried pulling that off kind of timing wise, and I like watched it and tried to see, okay, maybe in the edit I'll do like here. And so when I was acting, I would really focus on the timing of everything. And I'd end up getting off track a lot of times, so I would do a lot of takes just to be safe, which is very important, I've found, just doing a lot of takes. But yeah, that was sort of the process. It was really like, it wasn't anything super technical or professional. It was honestly just trying to get the right timing and trying to like make it seem like I was having an actual conversation when I was really just talking to the camera.
For someone who's not an actor, I think that's impressive.
Very like, thanks.
Do you guys have any questions for each other too? I don't want to, this kind of is a chance for you guys to talk to each other. Anything you saw in someone's film that you were curious about, this is an opportunity to ask them about it. I don't want to just be peppering you with questions that I have here. So does anyone have anything that, if you ever have anything you want to step in with, feel free to interrupt me. Okay, yes. Or raise your hand. They're so polite.
Hey,
Kid Natural. I'll go ahead. I liked all your films as a general for each one of your films, but I do have one question for Mo. What was your inspiration for making the Great Pancake?
Perfect Pancake. it's like some of my films, it's all about like what's around me and my resources. I practice resource filmmaking a lot. And what I did was I was in my house one day, you know, slouching in my couch. Maybe that's figurative, but anyway, I looked at my pancake mix. I looked at my kitchen. I looked at my audio cassette recorder and my table, and I just put everything together and came up with a story. Since I was all alone, well, with my parents and my family, but since I was alone, I decided to make a story of this guy who's isolated, and he, and this audio cassette recorder, which is imperfect because, you know, it's dated. Barely anyone listens to audio cassettes anymore, but compared to like CDs and stuff. But it's all about how this imperfect creation tells this one person, make the perfect pancake, make this perfect creation, and I want to see you do it. And it's all about that constant motivation. And I wanted to be sort of like there's the protagonist and the antagonist, but I wanted to see if I can make it with just me and me by myself. And that's why I had that audio cassette recorder being like sort of having a personality. So to answer your question simply, that's the inspiration, practically using my resources and coming up with a story around that, then writing the script. So there you go.
Cool. Very cool.
Thank you.
Another question that applies to all of you as creators, we're all under lockdown. We're all kind of stuck in quarantine here. What is something that you've learned, like coming at this from a filmmaker's perspective? How do you still stay inspired? How are you still pushing yourself to make art? I know a couple of you have made films while under lockdown. Maybe you've been more on the writing or editing side, but just, I don't know, what advice do you have for people who are looking to be creators, looking to be artists, but we're stuck inside and we don't really have fellow artists that we can see in person? And my screen starts with Brian, so.
Okay, I'll say this. There's no excuse not to do something. You got to figure out what you want to do, what drives you, what gives you passion, and then go pursue it. So you can always do something. You could write, you could make a movie by yourself, you could have your parents film you, right? You could always do something, right? So there's no excuse not to do something, right? That's all I have.
Very true. Ryan?
Oh, yeah, sorry. I totally got that half a look, tired face thing going on. In terms of, like, making films during quarantine, I made Salt and Pepper before the quarantine phase. In terms of, like, inspiring others, filmmakers right now, since we're, like, the shelter in place, if you got a heart to make a story for a short film, do it. And if you have the time for it, do it. Now's, like, the perfect time more than anything. Right now, I'm, like, working on, like, multiple short films and class assignments. So there with me, always have that drive and that heart. If you want to make that comedic film you never had like a year ago, dust off that script and make that. Now's a good time to do that. For being indoors, be creative. Look around your environment. See what's there. What's in its place. See, you can use that lamp for that lighting. See, you can make that mug for that prop. Scanning the whole area, pretty much. If you got that drive and that heart, you got those fuels.
Find the art in the surroundings.
Correct.
This is all good advice. I'm listening to all
this. Art
I'm
feeling the surroundings. Inspired.
Okay, Mo.
For me, at least, and for all of you who want to be practitioners of filmmaking, just watch a lot of movies with extreme limitations, especially during this quarantine time. Like movies that take these limitations but use them to their advantage to tell these interesting and compelling stories. So it can go from like a physical set limitation like Buried with Ryan Reynolds to like a one-shot only take what it looks like in, like in Birdman or like movies in rare languages like Apocalypto. I'm just saying a bunch of examples, but my point is if you watch media or like try to learn more about media that also is similar within low budget, very strict limitations, that can inspire you to do something about that for your own work.
Oh, I forget you guys can't see my screen. This makes perfect order sense to me, but Christian.
I would just say, yeah, I mean, I pretty much agree with all you guys. I'd say the biggest thing is like make something that you would want to watch. A lot of times, like people try to make stuff that just impress other people, and at the end of the day, it doesn't feel genuine, and like it just won't make you happy, like in your heart at the end of the day. So I feel like as long as you make something that you would like to watch, that you would enjoy, and you even enjoy making, I think that's the most important thing. And I feel like you'll get the most out of that experience. And you'll develop that. So it's more of a positive trajectory. Whereas instead of just making stuff for other people, it's sort of, you may be making stuff, but it may not be for you. And it may not be doing much for you at the end of the day. So I guess that's my advice.
No one's going to watch your film more than you do in editing. So to make sure you like it. Borna.
So right now I'm making a short film about the same question, like about this very situation that we don't feel that much motivated. We just wasted a lot of time. But like, I know that a lot of time I get depressed about this situation, but I want to believe that at the same time I'm working on this film, that I'm creating something at the end of it. Although I'm not like feeling good all the time, but sometimes like little steps that goes forward towards like making this movie, that makes me happy. Like all those little things that goes forward, although it's slow, but it does make you happy.
And Jessica.
Okay, so I would say I'm having a difficult time with staying motivated, and I love what everyone said. I give props to Christian and Mo for like creating those films during quarantine. I would say the one thing that would, you know, the one advice that I could give is just write anything, start something, and try to finish that. Even take time to, you know, relax and you know, just don't get too caught up in like, you know, trying to create something like really big. Like just write anything that you're passionate about. Don't like feel, you know, worried that everyone else is creating something and then you have to create something. Just like relax and write whatever you want to, you know, try to make. But yeah, I believe that's all you have to do.
Has anyone written any new scripts being on lockdown? Come up with new ideas?
Yeah, two. Pretty out there, actually. One's called Cash, which is kind of like, if I'm sure everyone's seen like Terminator or like the sci-fi apocalyptic robotic movies. So Cash is pretty much the cliff note of that. And that comes out later in the month. And another one's called Phantasm. And this one is my first dramatic short film, mystery. So it's about a guy named Thomas, young adult, comes home to his childhood home, but he learns that his brother's apartment is haunted and everything's not what it seems to be back at Lakeview, Maine. So it has that supernatural twist thriller vibe.
Sounds like some good pieces. And have a lot of work once lockdown's over.
Yeah.
Okay, Brian, I have a question here for you specifically. What inspired your universe? Like, why did you end up writing this script about a film noir? What was the inspiration behind that?
Well, we were part of film club and we had to do that, you know, challenge. So we had to pull out a prop and that was going to be the whole basis of the film. And so we pulled out a deck of cards and we took our group and went out to the area where we were supposed to film. And we talked about, it wasn't just me, there was other people talking about what kind of ideas they could do with cards. And I was like, well, why don't we just make the cards like the whole centerpiece? So basically, literally the initial plot was, like, it was kind of inspired because someone said, let's do like a noir spoof. And I was like, yeah, let's do something like that. But they had this more kind of convoluted plot. And I was like, let's just kind of narrow it down to like literally a fight scene. You know, it's like this detective shows up and he has a briefcase and he's trying to save his girl. And, you know, it's like we have all the tropes, like he's smoking and there's like, you know, black and white and there's music. And instead of having a gun on him, because it's campus, we can't do that, he has a deck of cards. And the deck of cards is actually like knives. And so there's a quick little dumb fight scene with these cards. And that. Then it decided to become like a comedy. Now there's like card puns involved. And so that's, it was more like necessity. But it was just kind of, we just created something that's very simple and just fun to make. And now it's been coming, now it's becoming something else. Now it's becoming, now there was a sequel that was made called Go Fish. And, you know, that took a little bit more time. And now we're making a third one called Blackjack. And so we're keeping with the themes of having these objects that are not weapons to be used as weapons and trying to just mess around and have fun. But that's really all it's about, you know, just mess around and having fun, not taking it too seriously. But yeah, it was just kind of born on the spot. But it has evolved to become something else than it actually was intended to be. So it's pretty fun.
I like this trope you and your team created of like, yeah, objects that are not weapons being used as weapons, because with sound effects, you created that effect really well.
But a lot of it also just real fast, a lot of it has to do with, it was very collaborative, the film is very collaborative, and so, you know, like we did this before the lockdown, so it wasn't just me who came up with it, it was everyone who was on set playing the characters, feeling out the role. So even though I wrote it, it was just a script and it was about how all the actors filled in those roles. So, you know, and that's how we kind of make it, and that's what's going to keep going. So hopefully we see more. We'll see what happens.
Okay, next, I have a question for Christian. So we loved your music video. I really liked watching it, like all the lighting and everything. But why did you and your team choose to make a music video instead of going with something that's, you know, copyright-free music, maybe doing something more of an original idea? What inspired you to pursue making this song into a video?
To be completely honest, the biggest reason we did that was to not have to deal with audio, because all the audio was already done for us. Me and Gavin, the person I make movies with, we got this terrible mic like a couple years back. No, I think like a year and a half now. And we tried making like films with it and it just didn't work out. And so we ended up just like kind of being in like this dead zone of not making stuff because our audio was so bad. And then I just was like, all right, I'm just going to make, like, let's just do a music video. And so we ended up using Beastie Boys. And then that was, like, the biggest reason. We also thought it, with music videos, there's almost, like, a sort of, like, it's implied that you can be experimental with music videos, you know, with, like, a short film. It has to sort of make sense with, like, a music video. The song is already there, and so you can just do whatever you want. Not to say you can't do that with the short film, but I was sort of under that mindset. And so so with the music video, we were like, I just got a bunch of like light panels and stuff from like Amazon. And we just put them like on lights and stuff. We just did a bunch of crazy stuff with the lights. And then at the end, we did that like crazy alien thing that comes out. And we just went like totally bananas. And it was a ton of fun. So I thought like, for me, like I always struggle with lighting and stuff. And so that I thought it was a great opportunity to experiment with it and improve it. And yeah, that was kind of it.
A question that I had personally about that music video was it just the three of you on your team, or did you have someone behind the camera the whole time, or was it the three of you trading off the camera and also acting?
Yeah, so it was Gavin was actually there. We used, he was recording on the camera. We would, it was just him. It was a really small team, but it still managed to work out. I mean, it wasn't too much manpower that we needed. We had my friend Steven, who played MCA, which is the guy, the tall guy with the deep voice, and Jules, which is actually Gavin's brother, who played the skinny dude with the sunglasses. So it was a team of four, but me and Gavin are the ones that can handle like the camera and the lighting and stuff, mainly Gavin with the camera. And so it was mainly just us sort of trading off whenever. He played the alien for a couple shots, so he has a little cameo in there.
Small team, but it worked well.
Only sold it. Sorry, I had to chime in.
Thank you.
It looked, yeah, I liked watching that. Like, I haven't seen a lot of music videos recently because everyone's kind of branched off into just doing their original shorts. But that's how I started making films, was music videos. So it was fun for me to see that again in a festival.
Great way to experiment, for sure.
Yeah, I really liked it too. I had a question for you, Christian. Leticia, I'm the film club advisor. And I really liked your music video. I have a question for you and Barna, because you two have the films that are the least narrative. So how do we go about writing? How do we get our ideas out, and how do we start the experiment? How do we prepare the shoot? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Barna, do you want to? I just talked, so if you want to go first, then I'll go.
Okay, so non-narrative. You should like each era, all of us we're just struggling with different problems, like different questions and stuff. So when I think about nothing, I think about that problem. Like that's the only thing that's in my mind. And I just want to express it into something. So maybe it's writing, maybe it's pictures. I didn't write anything for this short film, and I only showed it through different feelings, like different moods, different compositions, and I wanted those the frame and the composition to incept my idea. So I didn't have to write anything for this short film. Like I decided not to.
It was like, usually this is gonna sound so pretentious, but usually like when I listen to like music and stuff, like I always kind of like have like a little story in my head of what's going on. And so especially with like that Beastie Boys song, because it's so like dense with sound, there's a lot of stuff to play with in terms of like of what to film and everything. So like maybe my favorite part, it's up there, top three, is storyboarding. When it comes to like making films and stuff, I just love doing that. And I had a ton of fun doing that. And for me, like not having any narrative was really interesting, because it's not really like storyboarding. It was just kind of like, it was just putting images and just doing whatever. And I don't know. I just thought it was a lot more fun. It was definitely a different experience not having a specific story with it. There's sort of like a light outline, but yeah, it was definitely different, and it was a lot of fun to do.
Yes, Mo.
I wonder if I can add this. I know I wasn't picked, but I knew that I made a music video, and I would like to contribute since it was non-narrative. All right, thank you. So if you guys already know, it's a ski mask video for Billy and Mandy, which was a cutout animation, which means it's like paper cutouts, construction paper on a table, and I like move them with stop motion animation. And for me, I really purposely made it non-narrative, and I wanted to focus more on the hype and the energy of this rapper, because if you guys may not know, Ski Mask is one energetic rapper. He's like ballistic, you know. He was friends with X and Tentacion, and I wanted to show the hype and the energy and like the to have fun with it. And even the background is like it's literally blotches of paint to show like the ins and outs and extremes of this music video. So it was all supposed to be one hyped up animated experience, and I was proud of what I did. So yeah.
All the non-narrative films, they still tell a story. They still tell a story, even if they're a music video. Okay, so this question was directed to Jessica and Borna, but I feel like everyone can give us an answer. It was more of a technical question. They asked, what equipment did you use? What was your camera on? Did you use a tripod? Was it handheld? How did you get the style of your video? And I would like to hear that from everyone. But let's start with Borna.
Mine was just one DSLR camera and just the lens. I can show you this.
Show and tell.
This was the only thing that, like, no tripod, nothing. Just this one. Handheld. Yeah, nothing.
Your whole film was handheld?
Yep. Yep.
That looked very smooth for handheld. That's impressive. Jessica?
So as I said earlier, I used the Sony a7R III and I used a Ronin for like some of the shots. I believe I also use a tripod just to have stable shots. That's about it.
Brian, you're in the
Okay, we had two cinematographers. We had a gentleman named Anthony who is part of Film Club, and he was actually kind of skilled in cinematography, and so a lot of the stilted shots he actually got. Now, I don't know exactly the camera he shot it on, but he pulled focus, and he got, like, really good shots. And then I did a lot of the more handheld movement shots, and I used my, Panasonic GA5. It's pretty good. It has an internal stabilizer and things like that. So that's what I used, and that was all handheld. But he got most of the shots, and I think he used a tripod as well. But yeah, but he added a lot of like, kind of like a schooled methodology to his filmmaking.
Sorry. The artistic shots.
Yeah.
They look good. Okay, I'm naming in no particular order here. Ryan, you want to tell us a bit about the equipment you used?
Yeah. In terms of like camera, I used a Canon. Can I speak today? Canon DSLR, Canon SL1 for camera. I did some still shots off a tripod, and some of the handheld shots, that was just me and the camera. In terms of like props wise, salt and pepper shaker, and to create the illusion, making them animate and become alive, I actually took fishing line and took off the cap of the salt and pepper shakers. Then I put on the caps again and I like marionette it like a puppet. And that was pretty much the scene there, and obviously that dinner table. And that's pretty much what I used to create that story.
I think the effect worked.
Thank you. Originally, I was going to do a color. Then I'm like, when I'm going through the editing process for this one, I'm like, colors, this doesn't like hit me in my gut, in my instincts. It's not telling me this. So I'm like thinking, go black and white, go like, my story is about love and epic love. And I went with black and white.
Mo?
Well, for both the Perfect Pancake and Ski Mask, I used the Canon T6i, two lenses, 24mm, 50mm, both primes. I didn't actually use a tripod because I went through, two cheapo tripods. They broke on me, and I got one that was more for still photography, but I left it at a friend's house. So for my shots, I use a light stand, and I use it to my advantage as much as I can,
When you're in lockdown, you do what you gotta do to get the film made.
Yeah.
Christian.
For sound designs, we used a Panasonic GH5 for the camera. There was like the slow motion scene in the middle where everything's in slow motion and there's like fog, everything's dark. We were supposed to use a GoPro, but Gavin forgot to bring it that day. So we ended up using an iPhone, which is why it looks super grainy. Not that great, but I'm still happy with how it turned out. And then for lighting, we used these two softboxes that Gavin has, as well as I rented a Bowen Spotlight, I think. I'm not too sure what, I'm terrible with technical film stuff, so I apologize. But I think that's what it was. And we used that for like the brighter lights. And it was really lucky we managed to get it because apparently it's very expensive. So we rented it from there. And I think that was it. Oh, and Gavin has this really nice stabilizer as well. It's like this like rig sort of thing. And that was really nice as well. So we had like a lot of really nice stuff that we were able to use for that. I think that's it, yeah.
You said you used an iPhone. Did you record the slow motion in production or did you add that in post?
Oh no, yeah, that was in while we were on set pretty much. Yeah, we used that, yeah.
Okay, I have two more questions and then if anyone has anything else they want to ask from each other. My first one was, how did you guys come up with your ideas for your films? This came from the YouTube stream. And then I'll just combine this with, what was an important lesson that you learned on this set in particular about filmmaking or about yourself as a creator? Those general questions. And let's start with Mo.
Well, I think I kind of already explained how I came up with the idea to Ryan, but I can just repeat myself, maybe be a bit more elaborate. It's all about resource filmmaking, like I said, using what I have. And I always wanted to tell a story of how someone tries to convince someone to be perfect as they can, both comically and, you know, kind of dramatically. And it's all about, oh, I want this to be this perfect, this amazing, but at the same time, your perfection can really just rush you, and it can, and it's so unnecessary when the matter of the fact is that we're human, we're all imperfect, and sometimes perfection, if you do it too much, can lead to, ironically, imperfection. So I wanted to tell a story like that with just me, myself, and an audio cassette recorder, and I was recently starting to collect audio tapes, so. The second one was challenges, right?
Yeah. Or something you learned on the set.
Something I learned, right. I learned that no matter what, you can't make an excuse for yourself. Just like what Brian said, I have to congratulate, I guess, Brian for saying that. You went right on there, you know? It's all about how you can't make excuses. Anything, even filmmaking, is possible if you put your mind to it and just go out there and make something great.
Wise words. Okay, does anyone else want to go next? I don't want to be a teacher here. Okay,
right. I can go next. So, like, I made Salt and Pepper before the quarantine phase. I made this for the Real Love Film Festival. And prior to that, I can't take sole credit on this. Just the fact that during that time and the time of the release date for the releases for the Real Love, I was kind of like against time making Salt and Pepper, and a friend of mine, Anastasia, was like, okay, I get you guys schedule that out with actors and all that. Why don't you like take a Salt and Pepper shaker and make them your actors and give them names? And she literally grabbed my Salt and Pepper shakers in my apartment and was like, you can use these as characters. Then like, I'm thinking, I'm loving this idea. Then like one thing like sprouts one thought, then another sprouts another thought, thus became the birth of Salt and Pepper. So that's how the idea came about. Then like thinking, okay, I got a short film. I'm loving this. In terms of like what I learned out of this, I'm starting to realize I'm pretty good bringing things to life using fishing line. Cause I can probably like see myself on Sesame Street set, being a puppeteer, making things become alive, because it's like my second time, and making the song Pepper Shaker is like, okay, I'm digging this too much.
So you learned what you love to do.
Yeah, at the same time, creating things become alive, whether it's adamant.
Who wants to go next? Okay, Jessica.
Okay, so something, well, the story that I wrote was pretty much based off like multiple times that I've like had my phone on Bluetooth and somebody randomly airdrops something, like, you know, like funny meme or something during class, or, you know, just randomly. And I was like, that would be interesting if I could build a suspense off of that. You know, some, you know, mystery person sends you something on your phone and you don't know who it is. And, you know, where can that lead to? And so that was the main idea behind that. I just wanted to create a suspense. What I learned from the production, being on set, well, I was really sick that day. So I really, it was like a really hard time to get through that production. You know, I learned how to manage my time and like try to calm myself down, and knowing that my crew is there to help me and to support me. And Juliet was also a really great supportive person there on set, because I was like, oh my God, I'm so sick. Like, we can only film during this, you know, time frame. And just knowing that I have that support really helped me.
I was impressed by the dedication you put into that film. We're like, I'm filming this, I'm finishing it, and I'm sending it to my school. And she did. Okay.
Brian and I did get in with that film, so that was good.
Congrats. Which school was it?
Long Beach.
Congratulations.
Yeah, congrats.
Thank you.
Good on you.
Okay, Brian and Christian.
Okay, sure, I'll go real faster. So, obviously, I kind of already talked about how we came up with the story. It was just kind of circumstance. We just came up with it on the fly, and then I wrote a script, and we did it. But the story really came alive with the actors, right? And so film is very collaborative, and I kind of knew that, like, analytically, but actually experienced that and actually directing, I realized, like, how much of the story is actually done. You have to capture it on film. You have to do it there, right? So the actors really contributed a lot to the film. I mean, honestly, without them acting in it, like, it'd probably be much duller than it was. Also, we had a lot of costumes I provided, but, you know, it was cool. At least I had all that, right? Talk about making films of what you have, right? But the one thing that I really learned was sound design, right? So like I said, I had a microphone, a boom mic for like half the film. And then I kind of carried on and did a lot of the movement shots. And I realized, oh, I didn't really have a microphone. So I had used the internal camera microphone for both halves of the movie. And so I just went with consistency. But next time, you know, I'm investing now in better sound equipment to capture the audio as is and have like special filters on it and stuff like that. So I kind of get the dialogue there with like a shotgun mic or even having just like a lavalier. But you know, you got to do what you got to do. You got to film with what you have. There's no excuses. And that's the kind of thing I'm hearing from everybody too. It's like, no, I was sick, for instance, right? You know, or I was just making with the stuff I had. But yeah, definitely sound. Sound is so important. People will not watch your film if they don't like the way it sounds, right? That's not even, it does also include soundtrack. If your soundtrack is something they heard before, that's not like catchy, and the people are like, ah, it's dull, it's boring, especially if it's like a silent film. So you gotta be careful about that, right? So obviously, you know, just pay attention to microphone, invest in some equipment. If you're a filmmaker, just for anyone watching, invest in a microphone. Don't use your internal camera microphone if you can help it. Please don't. Just, I don't care how good your camera is, get something to help you out. It's going to make all the difference. That's all I have.
Definitely.
Yeah, I had a teacher once that actually, he was specialized in sound. And this was before I knew anything about film. And he came in, he was like, people will forgive. They'll forgive bad lighting. They'll forgive bad acting if your story's good. And if your sound design is good, they will keep watching your film. And at first I didn't believe him. I was like, sound, that's not important. But if, as you keep watching films with bad sound, you and films with good sound, you're like, oh, that does, he was right.
I think the thing that made it entertaining for my movie, just to elaborate on the sound, was the fact that I had like a cool soundtrack and a theme, and like everyone who participated was watching the film. So there was all this hype. They wanted to see themselves on screen. So like I was saying, it was part of the process of making the movie that made it interesting. It made it fun for these people, or else, like I said, like it's just in the ether. Like, who's going to really watch it? You know, that's the point. But who cares, right? You're just making movies to make movies. So there it is.
Your film really brought out all the characters' personalities too. And I think two of your actors got nominated for Best Comedic Performance because they were acting, they were using their skill set, and they were collaborating in your film. They weren't just actors that you had in this film. They'd been part of the creative process. You did a good job of bringing their characters out on screen.
And sadly, this is the one thing that kind of got overshadowed, and this happens a lot with film, is that you have a crew, right? And with doing short films, and all of you can talk about this, you know, you're wearing multiple hats. You know, it's not like a professional film set where you do one thing and one thing only. If you're the director, sometimes you're holding the camera. You know, you're going to be editing, you're going to be directing, you're going to be acting, you're going to be doing all types of stuff. And everyone can attest to that, right? A lot of my crew, like Juliet, you're on set really motivating us. I put you as a producer credit because you really did kind of produce it, even though you were being a VA, for instance, and you were like giving us water and stuff. And that really helped out too, the little things. And I don't want them to be forgotten. And that's why I try to put as many of them as I can in the credits. But, you know, obviously I probably would have missed somebody. So I try to make sure everyone's in there. But for everyone who worked on my film, and of course, probably all the directors are the same way, thank you so much. I mean, you're the reason why the film got made. You know, you're the reason why we're here talking about this.
Film was a team effort. That's why this lockdown is not doing us any favors, but we're learning new things. Okay, Christian, round us off with an answer.
Okay, well, a lot of pressure. So I guess, like, with the Sounds of Science one, definitely, like I said before, my main thing was, like, lighting and stuff. So I think, honestly, like, production design overall was, I feel like I improved on a lot with that specific film, and sort of like being ambitious with it. I think like before I would be, sorry, being reasonably ambitious before I would be like wanting to make like full length movies and stuff and like a huge cast and everything. And it just wouldn't make sense. And so, we scaled it back a lot, but we also kept it sort of in that nice medium where there was still stuff that I hadn't tried before. There was still stuff that improved how it looked, how it was watched, even like just stuff like that. And so I think that learning to kind of balance that ambition was definitely like a big thing that I learned. And I think just because, like, I mean, I've making films like constantly, it's also just helping me kind of understand my style and like what I personally bring to the table. I feel like, you know, like flashback 2 years, my films were a lot more different than how they are now. And I think that's just because I've been like, you know, constantly trying to make stuff and constantly developing my own style, and kind of just kind of putting my own stamp on what I'm making instead of ripping off stuff I like, even though I still am guilty of that. I won't lie, but yeah.
Thank you. Borna, I'm so sorry. Did you answer already? I feel like I jumped all over the board.
That's fine. I can add one thing.
Okay, I don't want to skip anyone, but I realized I...
So, one thing that I was struggling with during the film, that short film, was that I didn't know anybody. Like, I didn't have any friends, or it was before all this. I just jumped into class and, like, with this assignment, so I knew nobody. So the thing is that we should all try to meet up, like get these connections. Like, I had so many problems doing the short film because I didn't know anybody. So meeting is really important, like making all these connections, trying to help each other. This is like, yeah, this was one thing that I learned out of this short film.
I agree. I really do. Like, connections are so integral. It's a collaborative art. It's a collaborative sport, filmmaking. And yes, admittedly, I made a lot of films by myself, literally, but I'm improving now, just like you said, Borna, in terms of being more open and collaborative. But yeah, I agree with what you said.
Sort of theme everyone's been saying, like Brian brought it up. I think all of you mentioned this teamwork that goes into filmmaking. And that's not just like while we're students, that's going to follow us into the professional world. So I'm glad that you guys were able to get teams and were able to make films. And thank you for submitting to the festival and letting me watch all your work and letting the judges watch all your work. And it means a lot that we were able to, that the officers and I were able to plan a festival and then people got involved in it. And thank you for coming on today and answering questions that people had. It was great seeing people in real life again. That's cool. And also hearing about your creative process. I'm out of questions. Leticia, do you have any other questions?
I don't have any other questions at the top of my mind, but I wanted to congratulate all of you because you've worked really hard and all of your films were really touching, beautiful. And so I think, you know, really, I think it was a success, and I hope you see it that way for yourself. And I hope you continue to make movies. despite, you know, the continuation of our limited social existence. So yeah, that's it.
Does anyone else have any closing thoughts before we wrap up for the night?
Just one, just a dawn to me for a question, actually. This can apply to everyone here, even for myself. And the short films you submitted and nominated for, if you had to describe your short film in one word, what would it be?
That's a good one. Okay. Who's going to go?
And I'll kickstart it off. Mine was about forgiveness.
I would say mine's just, I would say it was fun. It's fun to make.
And the opposite of, beyond the real, his response, selfishness for Fistful of Paper, especially during the time of quarantine, and for Sounds of Science, Kooky, I don't know. I'll go with that for now. I'm going to regret that later, but I'll go with that.
All right. I would say for The Perfect Pancake, irony or ironic. And for Ski Mask Video, my animated one, Mosh Pit. Mosh Pit.
So for mine, I'm going to say like being, self, or existence. Being, yeah.
For my film Distractions, I would say dilemma.
The dilemma of distractions. You got some alliteration there.
Yeah, really.
Okay, well, I think that's it. Thank you everyone for submitting, and thank you for coming on. And I hope to see more work from all of you guys in the future. And how many people are still going to be at DVC this upcoming semester in the fall?
I will.
Just see more work from Film Club. I'm transferring, so I want to see what you guys are working on. So keep active, keep creating, and keep posting on social media, because that is how I stalk people's lives.
I'm at I'm at CRC right now, and I'm getting close to, hopefully I'm gonna pass these two classes. One is it's audio production, and the other one is beginning single cam production. And another thing I want to say is that I got future film going on for PCS, which is a place called Sacramento Film Festival. They actually, what they do is they pick 10 winning scripts, and like they go through 3 rounds of blind judging. So I'm gonna see how I can go about this thing. But overall, I'm doing great. So yeah, and I hope all of you do great too. I really thank you all of you for honoring me and for me honoring you back. I really appreciate it for this guy back in SAC.
Well, good luck in the Sacramento script, and good luck to all of you. Hope you still do creative stuff under lockdown, and I can't wait to see more stuff. Thank you everyone for coming on.
Oh, you're welcome. That was fun.